so fanatically endorsed, so exclusive of all recognized methods of healing aid except their own, so violently opposed to all the findings of the past, and so unwilling to cooperate with orthodox medicine that, in many cases, they constitute a definite and real danger to the public. It is largely their own faulty approach which is responsible for this, their undoubted ignorance of the nature of the human body, their attack on existent medical practices even of proven value, and their biased belief in the infallibility of their experimental techniques, have brought them under the attack of the rigidly orthodox medical practitioners and of the fundamentalists within the ring paths not of academic medicine. Yet within the ranks of medicine are many enlightened men who would gladly cooperate if the small and vociferous cults would relinquish their exclusiveness and be willing to cooperate and accept that which the divine instinct in man down the ages has taught in connection with the healing of the human body. It will be through the collaboration of the new experimental schools and the older and proven methods that the medicine of the future will be developed. All the many groups, even indifferent, lies in the fact that they point the way towards new trends and indicate the lines along which the medicine of the future can enrich itself and become better adapted to man's need. They are too experimental as yet to be trustworthy, and are not yet scientifically proven. They are pioneering groups, and have a real contribution to make, but this will only be possible if they refuse to divorce themselves from the past and are willing to compromise in the present. Academic medicine is the result of the God-given gifts of the human mind. It is a proven divine expression and a most beneficent force in the world, in spite of human weakness, commercial exploitation and many mistakes. It is the same with religion. Both of these great sciences must eliminate the reactionary and fundamentalist positions, and then proceed with an open mind into the new ways of approach to divinity and of approach to physical well-being. It might therefore be said that the main contribution which I am making at this time is to indicate the causes of disease and ill health which are not recognized by orthodox medicine, which deals with the effects of these subtle causes as they work out in the physical body and the nervous system. I am not dealing, as I have earlier warned you, with the symptoms of disease, with medical diagnosis or with systems of applied physical means to bring about cures or to ameliorate conditions. These have kept pace with man's growing capacity to discover and to know. Let me reiterate that I am laying the foundation for an approach to the subject of the physical body in health and disease which will deal primarily with the etheric body. This should. Copyright 1998 Lucis Trust. 166. A Treatise on the Seven Rays. Volume 4. Esoteric Healing. Eventually lead to an accumulation of knowledge and energy, its focal points and distribution in the etheric body, which will equal that already gained in the field of exact physical knowledge, and that exact knowledge is a fact. The study of inherited disease indicates a faint recognition of man's karmic liabilities and karmic tendencies. A mistake lies, however, in the belief that these tendencies are to be found in the germs of life and of substance, brought together at the moment of conception, and therefore that the father or the mother is responsible for the transmission. Such is not the case. The subject in incarnation has, from the angle of the soul, definitely and consciously chosen his parents for what they can contribute to his physical makeup whilst in incarnation. The vital vital body makes possible. The incarnating soul produces, in its creative work and in its vital vehicle, a particular constitution to which the parents chosen contribute a definite tendency. The man is therefore non-resistant to certain types of disease. This is determined by the karma of the man. It is well known to students of the esoteric sciences that the physical body is simply an automaton, responsive to and actuated by a subtler body of energies which are a true expression of the point in evolution. This point in evolution may be that of personality control, through one or other of its bodies, or of soul control. These are facts which the medical profession must grasp, and when it does, a great step forward will have been made. Esoteric students are willing to recognize that the physical body is automatic in its response to emotional, mental, or soul impression. So closely, however, is the etheric body interwoven with the physical vehicle that it is well nigh impossible to separate the two in consciousness. This will not be proven or possible until the science of etheric energy and the development of clairvoyant perception demonstrate the truth of what I say. This is again a needed repetition. Medical science, through its study of the nervous system and its recognition of the power of thought over the physical body, is moving rapidly in the right direction. When it admits, in relation to the physical body, that energy follows thought, and then begins to experiment with the concept of thought currents, as they are erroneously called, which are directed to certain areas of the etheric body, where the esotericists posit the existence of energy points or centers, much will then be discovered. Christian science had a sound conception and its original basic concept of the mind as a permanently existent factor. Its overemphasis upon the mind, its idealistic presentation of human nature, its expectancy of man's capacity to demonstrate today and immediately as a fully manifested Son of God with no intermediate or necessary unfoldments, and its contradictory position of using the energy of the mind for mainly physical requirements have soundly negated its basic tenets. Otherwise, man might have been permanently deluded. Had Christian science fulfilled the original intention of the group of initiates who sought to influence humanity through its agency, and had it developed the idea correctly that energy. Copyright 1998, Lucis Trust. 167. A Treatise on the Seven Rays, Volume 4, Esoteric Healing. Follows thought, medical science would have greatly benefited. Its presentation was both too high and too low, and a great opportunity was lost. Christian science has failed from the angle of the hierarchy, and its usefulness has been largely negated. Healers and healing groups work is yet at a great disadvantage, but they can begin now to work, and their work is of a twofold nature. 1. They can, through the power of directed thought, pour energy into the center, which is the determining factor in that area of the physical body where the trouble lies. If, for instance, the patient is suffering from such a difficulty as gastric ulcer, the stimulation of the solar plexus center may produce a cure, provided that the work done is purely mental and that the results expected are purely physical. Otherwise, the emotional nature will share in the stimulation and real difficulty will arise. 2. They can stimulate a center higher than the one controlling a particular area and thus, by the intensification of the higher center, reduce the vitality of the lower. If, for instance, there is disease or trouble in connection with the organ, organs of generation, as for instance disease of the prostate gland, then the throat center should receive attention. It is that center which must eventually be the recipient of the energy of the lower creative aspect or correspondence. This is called the technique of the withdrawal of the fire. By its means what you call overstimulation in certain cases, or inflammation in others, can be stopped. These two ways of using energy and thought control form the occult basis for the two fundamental methods used in directing energy in diseased areas. They produce, in the one case, an intensification of the life of the associated center, with a consequent definite effect upon the diseased area, or they lessen the inflow of force in the other case, and thus weaken the quality of the disease. It will be apparent, therefore, that much must be known of the effects of these two basic and different techniques before a healer dare work. Otherwise he might greatly increase the trouble in the diseased area and even succeed, which frequently happens, in killing the patient. There is another point which I would seek to emphasize. In all healing methods of an esoteric nature, it is essential that sound medical practices of an orthodox kind accompany the subtler modes of health. It is in the wise combination of the two approaches, and in the cooperative work of the orthodox physician and of the occult healer or healing group, that the soundest results will be produced. Students who attempt to heal will therefore need to realize two things: the nature of the disease, as diagnosed by a good physician, and the center which controls the area of the disease. The safest plan for the average student of healing or for a healing group is to work in cooperation. Copyright 1998, Lucis Trust. 168. The Treatise on the Seven Rays, Volume 4, Esoteric Healing. With some reputable doctor and in relation to the center which controls the diseased area. Initiates, in their healing work, deal with the higher correspondence of the controlling center, working always through the analogous emotional and mental centers. This is neither possible nor permissible to the ordinary healing group. The higher the centers considered, involved and dealt with, the more potent the results, and therefore the greater care required. The whole process is one of either stimulating activity or of withdrawing energy, of making more active an allied center and thus abstracting attention from the center governing the diseased area or organ, or of balancing the energies flowing between two centers and thus producing an equable and even interplay. The more the neophyte studies this subject of healing, the more complex it will appear, until the time comes when he can work in collaboration with some physician who has the inner vision and can see